Good afternoon, you guys. Good to see you. How's it going?
Good. How are you, Paul?
Very, very well.
It is a beautiful
Wednesday.
spring sunny day,
Yeah.
so in a good mood.
Yes.
So, has it been 2 weeks since we met last?
One, I think.
One. Okay, time
Awesome.
flies. All
I
right, we
know.
met last week. What have you been learning this week?
So this morning or earlier today, actually, we had our session on finishing up pushing from a PO to work order, routing templates, pre-processing checklist,
Okay.
and I think that's what we're in the thick of right now. So we'll wrap up the processing checklist next week, and then we're going to jump to purchasing. But
Okay.
that's where we're at.
That's exciting. So, I'm curious to ask because there's definitely a philosophical component to the pre-processing checklist, which for those, that don't know, it's basically a checklist that goes with every work order that is fully configurable, but helps make sure that the things that need to happen before a job hits the machine, and even breaking down the job after it's done a bit, happen so that when you are ready to, set up that job, you have everything you need. It can go as smoothly and efficiently as possible. You're not gonna realize at the last second, oh my gosh, I didn't buy this special thread gauge that we need for this job, and now it's just gonna sit for a day while we wait for that to overnight that tap or that gauge. And quite honestly, it was inspired by this book that we read a couple decades ago now called The Checklist Manifesto, where I don't know if you know this, but this medical researcher was studying I guess negative outcomes for surgeries, and was inspired by the pre-flight checklist that pilots use before they fly their planes. And it's remarkable. I think the statistic was when they put in a pre-surgery checklist, deaths caused by a complication or mistake plunged by 40%.
Oh, wow. Okay, so Dustin used that analogy today, like to help us explain, like think of it preparing for surgery, like think about the things that doctors have to
He
go through to do
knows the
this.
story. So
Yeah, and it
imagine,
helped.
a skilled surgeon who should be pretty much an absolute expert at what they do, still needing a checklist to make sure they do all the right things, so they don't make a mistake and kill somebody, right? So we're asking, you guys and your machinists and your programmers who are, I would say, arguably doing things nearly as complex as surgery, because there's a thousand details you got to get right for a precision machining operation to go smoothly and make profit on the job. And there's a lot of things you could forget to do, like order a special thread gauge.
Happens to us too.
And that just causes downtime and spindles waiting and throughput problems and late deliveries and could be scrapped depending on what the thing that didn't go right is. What was your thoughts on the concept of the pre-processing checklist?
I thought the checklist is great. And I actually had a question for Justin today. I said, so the, you know, are, is there ways we can modify the pre-process checklist? Because not all of it's applicable. I did bring up like there's a programming step prior to even having the part on the shop floor. And I asked him, I said, you know, can we take that off or whatever? Only because, you know, and then I was ended up being a dumb question, you know, for him, because I'm like, oh, most shops have programmers, you know, all the materials out at heat treat or, you know, any pre-process. You know, there's already guys working on it. And the way that we do it here is as soon as the part hits the shop floor, you know, and the machine's open and it's the schedule's open for that part to go on the machine, that's when we start our programming and setup and
Got
so
it.
on and so forth. As far as
So
that we go.
is that the way you do that today because that's the way you want to do it, or do you ever want to get to the place where the program is ready when the job hits the floor, so you can have less setup time, more spindle up time?
That's a great question. That's a great question. I think that is probably the ideal goal in the future.
The way like I receive the information, because he's obviously out in the shop. He does all the planning. He does a lot of programming and, you know, the machining, and I have like a different lens on it. So the way I see it and the way I'm trying to also explain it to other people on our team is, you know, it's a lot of information for us to go through the trainings and digest right now. Yeah. But going through that checklist is basically, it's all stuff we do, like from start to finish. Those are all things we come across at some point in the lifetime of the job.
Sure.
It's just us shifting that to the very beginning, right? So that's what's different. I'm trying to emphasize, like, it is nothing new. We know the information. It's just the time, you know, at which we're going to do that. And it's going to be better for us. So by doing that checklist, like today, for example, we put in, you know, a build to inventory routing, you know, 250 pieces. And Alex said, well, sometimes, you know, we're not going to have time for 250. Can we just want to run 125? And Justin explained, okay, so you're going to go in and change that number, right? You'll want to go to that line and change it to 125 from 250.
Yep.
But Alex and I were talking before we got on this call, like, you know, on our schedule, we know we're going to see, like, can you run 250 pieces? Is that going to fit in your queue, right? Because it'll turn red, or, you know, however the schedule works. So I think with pieces falling into place by us utilizing ProShop, like, our processes may change.
Very likely.
Because we are doing things in a different order.
Yeah.
So
that's how I understand it. Yeah, what we're kind of getting at here, I think, is sort of the crux of the sort of conversation that ProShop is really more than just a software package. It really is an operating system for how to run a machine shop efficiently.
Mm-hmm. And,
it will, you know, for our most successful clients, it does change the way they think about running their business in some ways. They're like, yeah, this checklist, yeah, we do all these things ultimately at some point. Like, we have to. You can't deliver the job without it, right? But if you look at when those happen, and the potential mistakes or additional waste that you can introduce by not doing them sooner or not doing it as completely. You know, super simple example is you have a part that has a special thread gauge. You need a tap and you need the thread gauge that you don't normally have on the shelf. If you don't think about that early, you're going to go to set up that job. You'd be like, oh no, I don't have this. I need to stop my setup. I need to, like, overnight something for the next morning, the machine's going to sit all day long, right? Mm-hmm. If you just think about it a little bit earlier, order it 3-4 days or even one day sooner,
mm-hmm.
the machine's not going to sit.
And one feature that I really liked, I forget which check part of the list it was, but you hit the check button, you know, next to it. And because it's all hyperlinked, like, it just takes you there, right? You don't have to go somewhere else and be like, oh, I have to go cross-check the rev, or I have to go cross-check something somewhere else. It's like you click and it's there. So that was also nice to see, because, like I mentioned, I think before, is we have, you know, 4 or 5 different places that we have documents and notes, and just to have it there for you, it's like, how can you not just take the time to do that step?
And I love that you brought that particular one up, because quite honestly, confirming you have the right rev of the drawing or model before you program it and spec to it, how many shops have made the wrong parts because they're looking at the drawing that they quoted to, not the drawing that came with the PO, and they didn't realize they made a small change and they make the wrong parts. That's so expensive and such a bad customer experience. But
sometimes, like, even our customers, they'll accidentally, like, we'll say, like, hey, the last time you ran this, it was to, you know, a B, this says A, and they're like, oh yes, that's right. Like, let me go ahead and fix it. So,
Yeah, when you start catching mistakes that your customer is making, they're like, these people are on it.
Yeah, exactly.
Um, Yeah, and that will drive that checklist and other things similar will drive that really best practice behavior. And that builds confidence to your customers and that they're like, yeah, this is the place to send our parts. You know, it's a good partner for us.
Yeah. So it's good. I think it was a really good tool, and it's just going to take like a mind shift to sure. the way we run things.
And I, you know, to reinforce the importance of it, I was just earlier today doing sort of a coaching call with a customer who was saying that, you know, he's run into this period of time where they keep making mistakes and scrapping parts. And I'm like, what's changed? You know? And he said, well, we got this big package of like 40 new part numbers and it's been consuming the shop for months. And I said, you know, are you doing that upfront planning, or are you dealing with such a sheer volume that you're like, let's just kick it out on the shop floor? And, you know, and he's like, yeah, there ultimately we realize there's a correlation between the jobs that he just kind of throws on the floor. Those are the ones that are having the problems. Those are the ones that are causing scrap and having to do rework and make them all over again. And that's just devastating. But if you can really have the discipline to do that upfront planning work, even though it might feel in the moment like you don't have time for it, it will save you 10x the effort later.
Yeah, that's what we're all kind of realizing, you know, because it's you scramble at some point throughout the, you know, life of the job for you know, whatever it is, a tool or a gauge or something. And just by taking an extra, you know, 10, 15 minutes in the beginning is going to save, we're all going to realize it's going to save us time.
And if you can even, hey, you know, get the checklist configured exactly the way you want it today, you can change it in the future if you decide to start programming in advance because you have the luxury of time to do that. And you realize that your spindles will turn more often if you do that, if you're not waiting to program. And once it's dialed in, then tell your team to hold you guys accountable. If we send a job and we haven't checked off the pink section, the first office section, kick it back to us, you know, tell us, hey, this isn't ready yet. You know, you haven't checked all the boxes. If they hold you accountable and you hold them accountable, then everyone's just going to elevate their game. Things will start running more smoothly.
Yeah. And that reminded me of the part development section too, which Absolutely. Is nice. I think that's nice for the operators to have that. I mean, like they, you know, they have a meeting once a week right now, but to be able to actually give direct feedback might be.
And so a trick there, Alex, is when if they come to your office and they say, hey, I got a problem with this program, this part, this work holding, whatever, say, great, thank you. Go back to your computer, put it in process development. Don't just tell me about it.
Yeah.
I have to write it down. You know, I want it directly in the system from you.
That's awesome.
Yeah. See, and then it's on paper and there's a trail. Cause we went through like if it was successful, unsuccessful, you know, and if it's unsuccessful, you add that follow-up step.
Sure.
You know, and so you find that solution. And then also the runtime.
Yeah, that was pretty cool.
I don't remember what it was called. There's a checkbox that you can hit to verify like the runtime is accurate.
Versus the estimated runtime.
Yeah.
When you click certified to run.
Yeah, certified to run.
It pops up to verify the targets.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, that's part of like a three-step approach to making your schedule as accurate as possible and your targets as accurate as possible. Mm-hmm. Where you quote, ideally, you know, you quote in ProShop what you think it's going to be. Sounds like, Alex, you're pretty good at knowing. Just you got a good brain for cycle times. But still, you know, you're going to make mistakes. You're going to not be quite perfect. Once you program it, you put in what your CAM simulation says. That refines it even closer. Uh-huh. And then once your machinist does that first full 100% cycle time, 100% run, you know, rapids and feed rate, it's like, yeah, this is the exact time out of the control. And then so you click that box, it prompts them for the target, the exact number. If you're making 100 parts and you change something that's 3 minutes different than what you estimated, that's 300 minutes of time that's going to change on the schedule. You know, that's half a day of better accuracy, either longer or shorter. So it's important to be that level of specificity of accuracy.
It is.
Exactly.
Yeah. That makes sense.
Cool. Well, I love that you're getting in all these new features and concepts, and the fact that you're open to it and, you know, eager to implement it and apply it into your business. That is one of the most important aspects of this journey, is having the open mind and the humility to say, yeah, this is different than we've done it, but we can see we can see the importance of it and the significance of systematizing the business so it just runs more smoothly.
Exactly.
It's exciting.
It's the end goal.
Yeah.
So you can be on vacation and the shop still runs smooth without you.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, thanks for sharing all that today. It's great to catch up, and have fun the next week, and we'll talk again soon.
Sounds good.
All right. Cheers, you guys.
Bye.